First, we're going to start with Mark, and I just wanted to talk about Nau for a really quick second, because I think, is there anybody in this audience who doesn't know the brand Nau? Of course not. No. And, you know, when Nau first hit the scene, you know, I was still, I kind of entered the industry when I was in my late 20s, early 30s, a little late. But when Nau hit the scene, you know, I had a fashion degree. I was doing, ended up doing outdoor at Columbia Sportswear. Like, how do I get my fashion into what I'm doing and whatnot? And when Nau hit the scene, it was like, you know, I just drooled all over it. Like, wow, this is awesome. I love the whole concept. We were all so excited about what we thought this brand could do and did. It really shook up the industry. And we would buy samples, bring them back to the office, talk about it, try to prove that we all wanted to do this. So it made big waves. And when it struggled and almost thought it might disappear, we were all, no, 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 let's go to the store, buy a whole bunch of stuff, support it. And then, you know, I bought my Horny Toad, a bit of like, oh good, it's still around, but what's gonna happen to it? Sorry, Horny Toad, but we Nau just represented something else, so we know that. But it was there, and I, you know, when we moved to San Francisco with the North Face, I was able to find Nau, you know, over on in Hayes Valley and whatnot, and still be able to buy it. So I was happy about that, and we really wanted to have Nau speak at this conference, so we were trying to reach them early on, because we had seen Mark speak before in San Francisco, Sam filmed it. It was really great. But we couldn't get a hold of them. They were a little busy, had a lot going on, you know. And then we heard about the Black Yak acquisition, and we went, okay, that's what they've been doing. Great, awesome, this is gonna be very cool. Then they reached out to us and said, we heard about your conference, we'd like to be involved. We went, yes, please, we really want you here. So we were very, very, very excited that, you know, they have this new thing happening, and we're really, really excited that you're here. So I'd like to introduce Mark Galbraith from Nau.
Well, thank you. It's an honor to be amongst peers and the people I really enjoy hanging out with. We're pretty damn lucky to be in this industry and be able to just do fun, creative stuff. You know, it's a every day is another work day. You know, I think people show up and it's like there's 300 emails in my inbox and I got shit to take care of and I got a grumpy boss and I didn't get enough sleep and whatever else. But the awesome thing is what we do, you know, it's, and to live in a creative zone and be able to, you know, create stuff that is beautiful, that we enjoy playing with, that really engages us is an amazing honor that we have. And, you know, I have friends that went into design and are involved in all kinds of stuff. And can you hear me very good? Is this, do I need to get closer? I'm like, project from the diaphragm. But, you know, and there's people who, you know, get to design stuff, but sometimes you look at it and you're like, wow, it's like rubber doorstops and shower curtain rings. That's cool. So I think we're incredibly lucky to do what we do. And it's an awesome thing to have a conference where people who do the kind of things we do can get together and have an opportunity to discuss things, have some interesting conversations, instead of a trade show madness where we're, you know, hungover and have to make a presentation and see 500 fabrics we don't care about and a bucket of plastic trim or something like that. It's good to have a chance to really talk to everybody and hang out. So it's awesome to have people here in town. It's been cool to have it here. And to me, it really underlines what it is we're involved in. And so, you know, when I was asked, when we, I guess we sort of asked slash, what can we do? You know, because we think this is you know, an awesome thing that is happening here. And, you know, the topic that we were kind of assigned or discussed was, you know, how do we look at design and to a degree sustainability being kind of at the core of Nau. And so I've had, obviously I've been thinking about this topic for a while, and I think sustainability is maybe a bit narrow in terms of the actual, you know, word. As anything, it gets kind of loaded. So whether it's eco or sustainable, everyone has their preconception of what that means, and, you know, whether that's just granola and dreadlocks or whether it's, you know, shit that doesn't look very good, but, you know, you feel righteous wearing it or whatever the case may be. I think for me, I like to start with maybe just looking at the concept of design in a little broader context, and then kind of bring it down to, you know, sustainability and creativity. So my first point here is that really design does equal change, and that if we kind of look longer term at, you know, what is the process of design, what's going on in design, how do we really view it, I'd like to first start off just stepping back a bit and calibrating our point of view of what design is. And I have a couple of quotes here, and I think the one from Bruce Mau is pretty interesting in that I think a lot of times we kind of get carried away with design as five categories I was asked to produce, you know, at $299, $199, you know, and please make sure it has, you know, these little features, and it's your merchandising ladder, and it's super inspiring. Sometimes, you know, a design is, here's this same block, I just need to do some surface color and stuff on it, and you're like, wow, okay, I'll come up with some designs. And, you know, and all those are meaningful challenges, right? We don't always have, you know, 100% of the globe to work with when we're doing design. But a lot of times I think we don't step back and realize what role design's played in our society and in our culture and where we're at with it. So I think the quote by Bruce Mau here is that, you know, design in particular, last 150 years being, you know, the major sort of industrial revolution period, and the last 50 years, is that design has essentially created this complete system that we live within. And if we just look around here right now, while we all come from some outdoor and passionate outdoor environment, and we think, oh, nature, everything we're doing, where we live, how we're communicating, what societies we're in, when we go outside, we're in all this highly designed stuff. Anymore, you're outside and it's like, okay, there's been a Google map made of the thing, and 20 people have taken an Instagram and dropped a pin here, and there's 20 shots from this point of view, and I can look it up on YouTube and whatever. It's become, you know, whatever we're doing in design, even the natural world, has become really infused with this designed infrastructure that's out there. And so design has impacted literally everything that exists in the world. And so I think that's the first point, is that there's hardly any place you can step into the design hasn't dramatically influenced it and changed it. And I think if you look through, you know, I like Steve Jobs' comment here, and he makes a distinction between sort of a man-made world and a natural world, but the design really is the soul in it. And I think Bruce Mau's comment here in Massive Change, that, you know, design and its power comes this set of kind of responsibilities. And so instead of thinking about my seasonal design or this exact product that I've got to design or something else, I think the point is to look at a broader perspective and history of design. So now we're going back to, you know, human evolution, the beginning of the world, because you have to start somewhere. But this whole idea is that if evolution has taken place, the point is any major leap has a massive influence back on whatever happened before. And so and it really creates a pretty big change in the way we perceive things. So if you look at, you know, what's happened in the geosphere, you have the Earth showing up at, you know, 4.2 or 5 billion years ago, depending on who you're following. Then you have the whole biosphere takes place, and, you know, the green stuff starts growing in the ocean, and everything comes around the world. Then you have, you know, the first upright bipedal, you know, person, Homo habilis, handyman, you know, at 1.3 to 1.4 million years ago. And then you have modern, you know, Homo sapiens upright, you know, anatomically pretty much us, 250,000 years ago. Then all of a sudden you have this conscious thinking, you know, human being like 50,000 years ago in the Upper Paleolithic. And all of a sudden, you know, every one of these changes has impacted itself. So the bare planet was nothing without all the biosphere on it. Then you get, you know, human beings and, you know, what's really happened there with us being, you know, stewards of the Earth and all of a sudden having it, you know, the power to live in the Earth and maybe even transform the Earth. And with that has come all these stages and steps. And there's been a big interplay of creativity, art, consciousness, thinking in what's going on in how we evolve as human beings. And it's, you know, for all those who, you know, had any of this forced down their throat in school or was personally interested in it or whatever the case may be, it seems really slow and, you know, this whole, you know, idea of how things evolve. But when you really look at where evolution is taking place now, it's not the geosphere or the biosphere, although there's massive impact back on those things. It really is happening in the mind space, the noosphere. And, you know, whether you're kind of the mystic crazies like Teilhard Chardin or Belinsky or these guys who talk about the noosphere scape, or if we're just talking about the cultural scape, it really is evolution and, you know, dramatic change is happening in the intellectual space, in the mind space, in our artificial created space. And it's then having a major feedback onto what's going on in the world. So if you look a little bit at some of that and how it's evolved, you always have this tie of creativity and art and culture that comes back on it and creates some of the most massive, you know, developments that we experience as human beings. So, you know, you have this great leap forward that most everyone's looked at in cultural anthropology and art history, that you have this sort of upright bipedals cruising around, and at some point at around 50,000 BC, there's this huge explosion that most people look at. It's quite difficult to understand what's there, just looking at some endocranial remains and some cave art stuff. But for the most part, people are saying what happens at this point is language, full consciousness, and art. And what the thing that makes us most human is what explodes at this moment. And it's intimately related to art, a consciousness of who we are as living human beings, and then trying to express it. And anyone who's had any art background can look at something 50,000 years ago like this and just be like, wow, the hair on the back of your neck stands up, because it's beautiful. And it's someone trying to grasp what's going on, and, you know, some wild shamanic hunting scene or whatever is going on here. You can have your theories about it. And there are plenty out there, including people just tripping on shrooms and, you know, shamanic madness happening. And there's a lot of theorists that say that's exactly how we learned language, was this massive input of biology into our brain and chemistry, and we expanded consciousness. Pretty much a hippie view of getting to be conscious, but who knows? Could be true. But nonetheless, is that that with this big change in technology and art and self-consciousness, all of a sudden, you know, modern culture essentially emerges at this point. And it is fused with tool making, massive art, technology, everything, and that all of a sudden creativity feeds back into what is happening in the world, and you get, you know, a huge significant change. I mean, it's moments from here. If you look at the sort of the time scale, all of a sudden you're in the Iron Age and people have plows, and, you know, Mesopotamia has turned into a big irrigation system, and there's massive surplus of food, and there's room to build a whole city state and specialize in arts and everything, and boom, modern culture happens like that. And it's a creative, adaptive, design-driven event, you know, that people are doing. And I think one of the other people who has a pretty interesting perspective on this is one of the interesting crazies from the 60s, Marshall McLuhan. Has anyone heard of this guy before? Okay, all right. Anyone who's over whatever age may have. All the aging hippies know Marshall McLuhan, which I'm proudly part of. Yeah, he's a Canadian guy, taught out of university in Toronto. Pretty eclectic individual, but his whole point of view was he studied literature, history, and then went into sort of communication and communication theory and social science and you name it. He synthesized a lot of things and was pretty out there. But his you know, two most seminal works, one of them, which I'm looking at right now, is Gutenberg Galaxy. And his whole concept with the book Gutenberg Galaxy, and it's a must read. You should just read it. Sometimes it's a little bit of a labor, but it's worth digging your way through. But his basic thesis is, and, you know, these are some of the words he's sort of famous with for, is this idea that the message is the medium, or we make tools and then the tools return back and shape us, and that the medium that we are communicating within is as important and tied to the message, and we create this medium that we're in, and then it dramatically changes who we are. And his basic idea was that, to begin with, we were in a acoustic space when we communicated and talked. And you heard me, and you saw, you know, body gestures, he's crazy, or he's very sincere, whatever the case may be. And you know, we hear it, we see someone's voice, we talk about it. That moves to a manuscript culture where it's monks and priests writing, and it's a pretty different communication mode. And then it moves to the invention of the alphabet, movable type, and Gutenberg's press. And all of a sudden, communication, which was oral and tribal and heard, becomes mechanized, linear, generally right to left. It moves from a very multi-sense environment to a more single-sense environment, just visually moving across the page. And that the medium of alphabet and movable type dramatically, as a creative invention about, you know, what happens here, changed the sense perception and ratios, and basically set the path towards a linear society, towards progress, towards compartmentalization, to the Industrial Revolution, to Newtonian physics, to whatever. And so you think, what? You're kidding me. Alphabet and a press did this? I mean, his view was that the mobile book was like a hydrogen bomb that exploded and dramatically changed everything. Because now learning could go forward in time, and that it could be disseminated widely. But at the same time, it was a narrowed, sequential, different view of how information was transferred and how language was transferred, and it dramatically changed the way people thought about everything. And it was the precursor in his mind of the Industrial Revolution, right to left, a non-synthetic environment where you synthesized a lot of different input. It became, in his mind, male-dominated, literal, industrialized, mechanized, repeatable, kind of everything that dudes like, you know. It's just the off and on button, sex, sleep, we're over. Not really. It's more complicated than that. But anyway, a lot less dials to adjust. So you know, his theory and the point of going through this, whether you completely agree with it or not, most people who've studied, you know, many of you probably had art history or something else going on. You look at all this and you realize, wow, we have created through all these technologies, which are amazing designs, this complete infrastructure that we're embedded in. And in today's world, you know, here we are in the Internet of Everything, this sort of global mind. And, you know, McLuhan kind of became the patron saint of Wired magazine. I think it was a late 90s edition where they did a whole kind of deal on Marshall McLuhan and said, yeah, this guy predicted the Internet almost 30 years ahead of it happening because he envisioned with early technology of computers and TV this sort of global electronic village whereby the mediums were literally extensions of man and humankind, and this was like an extension of your whole neural network of your brain. Pretty crazy thinking at the time, but you observe it now and it's like, I don't remember shit anymore. It's just there. The phone number is there. I have to look something up. I do it, and it's now become the extension of my mind. And it's changed how we think, how we look. It's changed that I can't even talk to my kids at a meal because their face is in their fucking phone. But it's dramatically changed how we communicate, what's out there. So the idea is technology is reflexive. Design and things we create are reflexive and affect every single thing that we do. And that ultimately, often we take this for granted. You know, we live in this world where we're interconnected in this design matrix. In the little world we're in here, and it was interesting to look at the kind of session yesterday where we were talking about what are the frustrations of design, and there's this little process that's been designed above us that has been designed by business, which is here's what we have to produce, here's the price points, here's what goes on, here's the market that we're in, here's how we've defined it, and then we're sitting here as creatives going, how come I can't get myself out of this box sometimes? And it was interesting. You know, there were some good solutions and there was some purging that went on. Maybe we feel better. we're in this system that essentially we've taken part of designing and other people have designed, and now we have this little outdoor industry that designs stuff, and all of a sudden we've designed ourselves into this little box again, and we're now thinking about, well, okay, systems on top of systems. How do we unstack the Russian stacking dolls and decide, you know, how, what's the perspective for design in a bigger sense? And I think sometimes we, you know, if you have a session like that, or you think about, you start to actually look around and think about how designed and interconnected the world is that you live in, it's kind of shocking. But most of the time we don't think about it. We take it for granted until either there's a massive failure in a design system, or we see a design that, you know, is completely used for the wrong reason. So, you know, I would say if you look at, you know, good industrial design, Mikhail Kalashnikov, the AK-47, I mean, an awesome design. Lightweight, simple, reliable, cheap to manufacture, durable, but probably the gun that's killed the most people in the world. So, fabulous design, but, you know, used for the wrong reasons. Designs that, stuff that has really good intent, you know, that benefited the world, but was a design that was so complicated and somewhat out of control, it nearly collapsed. So the economic system that we've all been enjoyed working in since 2008, you know, was a highly complex design. And nobody involved, I'm sure, in the financial sector said, I'm going to design this to fail, because they didn't want it to fail, obviously. But here's a design system that came very close to near total meltdown. And it affected every bit of our lives. But it was a thoughtful design put together by smart people. But it was a system that maybe didn't always work. The film of the Tacoma Narrows Bridge, if people have seen that one, where the wind comes up and all of a sudden someone had forgot there's a resonance pattern that takes place when wind goes across a particular shape. And you look at this giant bridge and you're seeing this huge, you know, asphalt bridge going like a piece of, you know, pasta until the thing just completely collapses. So, you know, so a lot of times we think, well, we don't realize we've designed this complete system around us. And a lot of times change doesn't happen until there's a dramatic failure, or we really realize, well, we've designed ourselves into a complete mess here. And I think in today's world, we're now realizing that there are some significant problems with what we've designed. You know, for better or worse, we've designed a petrochemical-based economy. We've designed, lots of systems that have worked for a while, but, you know, in some cases aren't working so great right now. And there's microsystems we've designed all together here in this outdoor part of the business that haven't always worked. So what is our role then? If we expand our idea of what design does and how it influences every single part of our life and its power to transform either knowingly or unknowingly, what does it mean to be a designer and an artist, and what responsibility comes with it? The upper quotes are a little more spiritual hoo-ha, but I think art and design is that way. It's something we feel deep and visceral about, and it's a spiritual process in many ways, or a deeply personal process. And then I think the last comment here by Bruce Mau, which basically summarized his book Massive Change. He said, "My book isn't about the world of design; it's about designing the world." Pretty radical shift in how he thinks about that, but it's hard not to agree that when you look around the world, it is a design structure we're living in. So what does that mean for us, and, you know, how we treat design and how we think about it as people, and how do we elevate the idea of design's power, and what it is that we're doing in the world as designers? What's our intent? Let's get beyond the seasonal thing or the pretty thing or the patina, and what's the core mission of design, and what do we all have as that responsibility, and what can we do in our industry? Essentially, we designed ourselves into some of these corners, and design can get us out of it. And there's plenty of great examples where that's happened and where the trends are incredibly positive. You know, one of the things we do is we make things aesthetically pleasing, and we have a huge audience out there, and we can create context for stuff. So I grew up in the 60s in a super progressive town, Salt Lake City, Utah. And and there was like two health food stores there. And my mom was like a classic hippie from California. And we had to raise chickens, and we couldn't have, you know, growth hormones and horrible shit like that. And I had to go to, you know, the local sort of hippie co-op and, you know, work my way through dreadlocks and patchouli to buy bulk food that looked like cardboard. And that was it, because that's how, you know, we were going to eat. And, you know, if you thought school lunch was basically starting a heroin habit in my family. So there was no way. And, you know, and occasionally when you had the chance, you're like, hell yes, I want Cheetos and a Coke right now. And if you slept over a friend's house, you're like, Captain Crunch with sugar on top of it? You're like, this is good stuff. But ultimately, that, you know, the experience of like, okay, well, how, you know, before, you know, eating healthy and organic food and growing your own and the, you know, local food movement, everything took place, it had to have some change in its aesthetics and environment. And, you know, fast forward not that long and you have Whole Foods. Well, why is Whole Foods successful? Well, I mean, you can argue whether it's cool or cliche to, you know, go there, but the point is, it all of a sudden became accessible, it became more shoppable, the packaging was something that people knew, it wasn't a place that you felt uncomfortable to go. It's like, I'm not the, you know, co-op shopper, or I'm not, you know, whatever the case may be. I have an allergy to smell of patchouli or whatever. So, you know, if you go into that environment, now you also have places where you can shop easily and it's accessible. So a lot of times we both take the design and we create all the context for it and become something cooler and more interesting. You know, there was a point that eating cool food, what was futuristic and interesting, was going to be like Tang drinks and space bars because astronauts were going to eat them. I mean, I saw this shit on TV, and I was, what a nasty concept of, like, you know, food being delivered in, you know, a plastic tube because you want to be a spaceman. So the idea of really kind of bringing back, you know, a connection to local food and taste, and, you know, it's huge. And so, you know, there's been those kinds of things that's happened. And it's always been the creative class and the early adopters. I mean, if you look at whatever it is, salon culture in Paris, or the cafe culture in greater Europe, and everything that really kind of happened with a lot of the major Western ideas in art and literature. Look at the countercultural revolution of the 60s, or the social movement of the 60s. It's the early adopters, it's the creative class, it's the design class that does it. It's never come from top down. I mean, there's rare instances where that's the case, but ultimately, it's us in the room who are the early adopters, who are the creative ones, who have the open mind, are the ones that are flexible and movable enough to bring in those kinds of ideas. So, fractals and dinosaurs. It's because most of these bigger changes happen when something goes on. So if you have Marshall McLuhan's idea of the message of the medium, you have kind of the new modern sense of what's going on in science and evolution and history. And, you know, most of these systems we look at are what are now called these chaos dynamical systems or dissipative systems, where a form happens when a lot of energy goes through it. So you've seen this all the time if you, like, take a bath and pull a plug out of the bath and all of a sudden you get a little whirlpool. That thing stays as the energy goes through it. As soon as the water gets low, it kind of goes, and then it's gone. And most of these systems or structures happen because energy is coming through them and they're interesting and they stay there. And when some dramatic thing changes, then there's a bifurcation, energy goes somewhere else, and some other new system sort of develops. And so it's about big change and these sort of nonlinear systems. They're not as simple as you think. And the old ideas of evolution that were around this sort of phyletic gradualism, you know, modern writers like Stephen Jay Gould have come into it and go, no, it's punctuated, it's big evolutionary leaps. And many of these things, these big changes, 60s countercultural revolution, reaction to shitty pre-packaged food, everything, climate change now and people thinking about other things, you know, significant energy issues and cost of oil and wars in the Mideast, and all of a sudden it's cool to drive a hybrid car, whatever the case may be. There are a lot of times these are really changed by big changes in what's going on, dramatic leaps, big, you know, disturbance patterns coming in. And we're in the middle of one right now in the outdoor business. Being into my 50s and having been involved with it for, you know, kind of 3 decades, I've seen kind of a interesting phase of what's gone on. And having companies here like Polar or Outlier or a lot of the younger companies that have come into it and said, okay, Grandpa, you know, fucking cool, but not so much. you know, that happens, and that's actually what's supposed to happen. And we're supposed to be helping it happen. And And so it's a big change. I mean, it used to be little specialty mom and pop shops, and it was super tech oriented, and it was 90% dudes. I mean, it was a complete sausage fest in the outdoor business when I first started going there. And Team Kielbasa is a little bit smaller now, and there are more, you know, there are, you know, it's a little more balanced, but a long ways from being where it should be. It's dramatically, the distribution has changed. I mean, if you, everyone follows what's going on, but, you know, internet, you know, specialty will always be there because, you know, you're going to touch, it's tactile. I mean, one of the reasons we're all here is clothing is incredibly passionate, and gear is incredibly passionate. We're not creating some just pure concept thing, right? Short of being with another human being or eating an amazing meal, putting something on next to your bare skin or holding some tool or something in your hand and doing something. I mean, it's the most pleasurable stuff there is, right? It's just tactile and sensual and fabulous. So that'll always exist, but you know, the modes of distribution of product, how we communicate, everything, it's all dramatically changed. So we either have to kind of update what's going on, or we will be with a Tyrannosaurus Rex somewhere, and someone else is gonna come along and do what needs to be done. So it, for us, I think the challenge is, and my point here is, let's elevate our point of view of what design has as an influence in the world. It's enormous. Let's really look at how creative it is and how we can really create change. And we're in a point where a lot's going on. How many scared CEOs or product line directors or marketing managers or finance guys? I mean, it's like stuff is changing, and it's unnerving. But it's the way to come into it. And it really is going to come from design. I mean, there's a few lucky people here who literally they own and run their own business, so they can do whatever they want. And you know, and some stuff will fail. I mean, failure is a part of creativity. We all know that, right? It's just what it is. But it doesn't come top down. Another interesting book that I think is a good read is DeLanda's book on 1,000 Years of Nonlinear History. He takes the kind of the opposite viewpoint of history and development and says, look, all these other things come in and create a real dramatic point of view on history. And just a little quick paragraph of, okay, why did Europe and its economy and its thinking become world dominant, you know, except for obviously we're seeing a shift to the Pacific Rim now. And, you know, Jared Diamond and, you know, Guns, Germs, and Steel had some point of view as to how that happened. But ultimately, you know, DeLanda's point of view was it was because all these technologies and all these things that were pointed out in Guns, Germs, and Steel by Jared Diamond, everyone had them and actually had introduced them earlier, both in Islam, you know, and in China. But his point of view, which I think is pretty interesting, is because Europe was still very chaotic. There was, you know, merchant class, there was religious division, and these more monolithic cultures that had top-down control didn't make the changes. And so Europe was able to make the change, which is just another case point for the fact that if you're waiting around for top-down control to make the change, you're going to be waiting a long time. And you may as well decide to do something else, because it's not, rarely is it going to happen. There are the few visionaries, and that happens, but largely that's not the rule, you know, over time. So yeah, now's the time to do something. You know, use design for the most inspiring way that you want to change what you want to do. And it's up to you to decide what that is. I'll talk a little bit about the Nau experiment and what we were thinking in terms of how we went about thinking of change. And I just want to go through what I think are the important things that help create. You obviously have to have a passion and vision and some inspiration of why you want to do it. Everyone's here because of some reason about that. And then once you get in the system and the machine, sometimes it wears you down a little bit and you're like, you're kidding me, another season? Wow, I'm super inspired. And sometimes you have to step out and re-inspire yourself. So I put down what I thought were the things that really were successful about Nau, and Nau's had some success, and Nau's had some bumps, and you know, we're still a ways from really proving it's completely successful. But these are some of the things we did when we put together, how do we use creativity and design to solve some problems, and what do we want to do, and what's the way to think about it? So passion's important, and having the vision and inspiration's important. For me, the Nau experience started with Eric Reynolds, who had the original idea of Nau about sustainability and business and e-com and direct and high level of philanthropy and giving and involving the community in it. That this was his point of view. And we'd been friends, and we met at a sushi place and drank like five bottles of sake and were talking about it. And then he finally said, okay, I'll tell you about this idea because I knew he had something cooking and that's why he wanted to talk to me. He said, but first I need you to sign this NDA. And he handed me something. I'm sorry to ask a friend to do it, but I want to tell you more about the business plan. So he goes, I got to go to the bathroom for five, you know, you got to drain a few bottles of sake anyway. So I get this thing that says UTW Inc. on the top of it. And I go, he's already incorporated, and what the hell is UTW Inc.? And then he went to the bathroom. When he came back, he didn't look this good, but he was wearing a t-shirt, and I realized that UTW was, in his mind, Unfuck the World. And that was a Michael Fronte t-shirt for a while, and it's become a whole thing. But he came back in an Unfuck the World t-shirt, kind of like Superman changing in the booth. And he said, this is ultimately the plan for the business I have in mind, is this, to unfuck the world. I'd like you to be a fellow unfucker. Will you join me? And I said, fuck yes. And I tell that story because I think anything has to have some vision and some sort of sense of irreverence and, you know, in this case, maybe a megalomaniac, you know, level of hubris, probably. But you have to have that. So I think, you know, whatever you need to do to kind of keep that fuel, it's got to happen. You have to have that in your tucked away. And whatever it takes to get that back again, whether it's time out, whether it's taking a sabbatical, whether it's doing the things that you're passionate about and love, or really reconnecting to it, whatever it is that you got to do, you have to do that, and you have to kind of keep that vision and power there. And it goes through cycles. You don't always, you know, the tank runs out sometimes, so you have to take some time to charge it. But we definitely had, you know, an interesting vision around. The second thing is, I mean, there are the few, you know, Tom Fords who can go, I've designed it, I've done this, I've, you know, can do the whole thing, and it's very top down. But most of the time, it's absolutely not that. It's a creative group that gets together that makes anything happen. And, you know, it's to solve any significant problem, it's distributed problem solving. There's technology involved, there's everything. So we had the luck of bringing together, you know, Jamie Bainbridge, who's totally awesome on fabric and development, who's on the OIA board to really kind of look at materials. We brought together, you know, an amazing group of designers and kind of created what I think is a brain trust or a solution group. And Carrie, who has done a lot of work with Nau, showed me one of the articles she really liked, which was Ed Catmull, who some of you may or may not know, but he works at Pixar, and he and Jobs were at Pixar for a while together. And the article is pretty interesting, and he has a book coming out, Creative Inc., which I haven't read yet, but the excerpts from the Wired interview were pretty interesting. But he hit on this same particular point, which is it's important to put together your little brain trust or your creative group. And does this sound familiar to anybody here? This, you know, you start into a project, and pretty soon you're like, well, I've lost a little perspective. I need some help on something. Yeah, that happens, right? And I think sometimes, you know, it's that, or sometimes it's just, it's perspective or point of view. Sometimes it's actually, you know, someone who can answer a question that isn't your level of expertise, because it requires that. So I think one of the things too, if you're going to solve any problem or do anything really, you know, that moves forward, you got to do that. And his comment with Pixar, the movies, is at some point all of our movies sucked. Probably that's true with most any designs I've been involved. Once in a while, it's a brilliant idea, and the first rough sketch or talking about it is like everyone gets it and goes, that's cool. A lot of times you're like, okay, it kind of sucks, but I can see it in my mind, and you figure it out. So sometimes you need some help with that. Sometimes you're communicating it to a group, and you see it in your mind, but how you've communicated it, whether it's a clumsy drawing or your inability to say something, or you haven't had enough coffee and you're not awake that morning in the design review, or whatever it might be, you need that creative group who provides perspective, helps figure it out. And I think the most important thing in that is a sense of trust, candor, and a little bit of grace involved in the process. I mean, most of us have to have thick skins if we've survived any time in this. But you know, if the creative sessions or review meetings or the brainstorming about what you're doing, if you're getting more honesty in the hallway after the design review, or you're getting the only real feedback after the end of the day at the bar going, I can't believe how fucking stupid my boss is, and I need another margarita, then you're not, which I need them most of the time, but you're not, nothing's happening. You're not getting honest and fair feedback. So I think one of the things that Nau did was really try and create a group of people who were talented, who could trust each other and had real honest, open communication about trying to solve some big problems. And it's a little scary to be five people sitting around a card table going, we have to create a brand, a product, get it to market, and we don't have much more time than a normal design cycle of 18 months. It was a little rushed. It was kind of nuts. But if there was any success in it, was because there were people, that group had been put together, and we could use it to solve something. So I think that's super critical. The other thing, and I'll move along a little faster, is you have to honor the process and give it some time to have the process. And everyone's been through this exact same process a million times. But a lot of times these get skipped, or these things are run by your development calendar, and someone goes, I did the development calendar and I'm the development person. So I need all the time to develop the product, but here's steps 1 through 5. You need to get those done. See, I need it by whenever. So I think just honoring, and it's not necessarily the calendar, it's just the space or the time to do it. And I think, you know, the research part of it, letting it incubate, you know, that kind of creative flashes that come when you've had some time to think about it and you're maybe not face down or looking at the computer desperately trying to get a bill of material completed for a design that's maybe not totally complete in your head, because by God, you got to get that first proto. You have to give yourself the creative time, the creative space to take care of it. And then it's, you got to do it again. It repeats itself. You're going to fail. Failure is fine. That happens. So don't worry about it. But give yourself the time to do that. And then I think the other thing is, create yourself some guidelines or a design manifesto or do something. I put this huge document up here because, as an example with Nau, when we got together, we said, all right, ultimately we want to do quite a few things, arguably too many things, and then Apocalypse Nau happened. But we said, let's try and be as sustainable as we can on Prague. Let's try and push aesthetics as much as we can. Let's try and go customer direct and change the shopping experience. Let's try and fuse digital with retail in a different way. We tried to kind of like adjust everything all at once while, you know, roaring down the runway, hoping the plane got put together by the time the takeoff zone happened. And one of the things we really said was, let's, with this creative group and an idea of what we want to do, let's set some guidelines up for each other. And whether that's your internal design manifesto, whatever it is, this is what we put together, was this idea of ideal design criteria. So instead of telling you what you should do to be either sustainable or use design for change, this is just an example of one of the things you can do. And you have to put some guidelines up. Not, you know, creativity needs a lot of space and openness, but then you need to kind of aim somewhere. And sometimes that's really refreshing to, you know, freedom is both necessary and completely terrifying when you're given all of it at once. Then you're like, holy shit, what do I do now? But so put together some guidelines and whatever those might be for you. For us, what was remarkable about going through this process is today the steel guides of Prague. We hit pretty high on most of these. Some we don't do as well as others. But this was really about looking at sustainability efforts around our product and setting up some guidelines that we're going to make or not going to make. And so if we're outsourcing a raw material or we're looking at a design, or looking at any other processes, we ran it through this filter to try and make sure of it. There's a whole other separate set of filters that were much more about how we think about the aesthetics and the approach to stuff, which really kind of echoed the last session yesterday, which was our idea of real clean, simple, classic, you know, kind of reduced design is essentially what it was. So I didn't want to repeat those here. But you have to put some of those things up there and run yourself through them. And then we kind of tried to look at sustainability specifically in more than one area. I think everyone either looks at the social side of it, we give back, and you know, there's amazing companies here that give back to all kinds of stuff, whether they're part of Conservation Alliance, which is a great industry sort of related part, whether there's individual areas that you want to be interested, you can do that. You can look at a percentage of giving. You can look at, you know, for us, we felt it was as important to be honest inside as it was outside. So we set up standards about how would we treat our own employees and ourselves just like we'd want to treat the supply chain or the world we operated in. So we said, look, you know, we don't care what your situation is, that you're going to have health care for you and your significant other regardless. We're going to, you know, set some bounds between lowest paid and highest paid employee and try and make things, you know, more fair and honest. So we looked at some things socially, internally as well as externally, that we wanted to look at. We looked at, and people do that, and that's you know, out there. We looked at the material side of things, and then we looked at the aesthetic side of things. You know, if something's more multi-use, if something's clean, if something's classic and longer lasting, it's a piece that isn't just consume and discard. So we tried to look at sustainability or good design in these three lenses and have some opportunity to think about that. So how do you get started with it, you know? And just, you know, let's last a little bit, folks, to bit on what the Nau process was, but Nau had a, you know, has a specific point of view, but you as designers can have any point of view you want. So my point here is think about your intention. Align your passion with what your intentions are and what you want to design and what you want to do. Believe in the power of design. I mean, if my little trippy thing through history may be somewhat obscure, but ultimately what it was trying to do is set the stage of design has influenced everything and can influence everything. So take the responsibility for it. You know, as the designers, as the creative class, we often are the ones that are creating what the vision is, what it can be. So however, whatever you decide you're going to do, whether it's just talking about how you want to live in the world, whether it's supporting something that's social, whether it's really looking at your, you know, real specific areas of design, it's a requirement being a designer and a human being. You know, I think when we think of anything we're doing, the minute we go, I'd like to make this, all of a sudden there's this giant interconnected web, and it's a farmer making some raw material or a chemical company doing something, and it's all the energy in the process coming into making something, and it's the customer we're talking to, and what is it for, and what do you use, and what's the surrounding culture for. It's this huge web that your ideas and your creativity spread everywhere and affect positively or negatively or neutrally something. So think about the impact of your design and what you can do. I would say also start with the core. And have some balance between it. You know, you can have an awesome design, and that's only going to delay the ultimate discovery that there's a rotten core if the core isn't there, right? So design can be a nice little, you know, someone can walk in the room and go, wow, that person looks totally hot and put together. Two drinks in an hour sitting next to them in the bar, you're like, disaster. So, you know, maybe. So the surface thing can, like, hide something, right? And it can do that for, you know, various. I mean, all of us have probably seen something or like, that's totally cool. That's a great brand. It's an interesting idea. And then, you know, you decide to get one. And you're like, bummer. You know, didn't quite. So and inversely, you can have, you know, awesome ideas, and you know, it's difficult to get the right product out there. So I mean, you always have to balance these two things and really make sure it's as tight as you can. And then prioritize what you want to do. I mean, you know, I put down here two areas, but there's way more than that. But if you're looking at sort of the life cycle analysis of product, it really is, it's like 40% of it's the raw materials that go into it. So that's your, you know, from a material standpoint, that's your biggest impact. The second one is, you know, 40% of it's actually the care that goes into it. So laundering, energy, water use, all of that in a real life cycle analysis. We don't have much, I mean, in the outdoor business, we make such technical, quick dry, whatever, we're pretty low care. So maybe the real thing is telling people they don't need to neurotically wash everything and they can rinse it and hang it out or whatever. But you know, you can communicate that side of it. The rest of it, transportation, manufacturing, they're pretty minuscule. You could spend your life around those things and, you know, have a couple of points percentage hit on what it is that you make. And then there's just the whole social area, right? I mean, one of the things that we do that's I'm sure we're all psyched about is we're in a industry that is like, get out, be healthy, enjoy the environment, with the hopeful idea that if you do that, you care about the environment you're in. And that environment should be as much of what it's like in the city you live in, as well as, you know, preserving wilderness. That should go out to what about people and causes and things you want to be involved with. So your role, in many cases, your own individual company, everything, you as designers, you know, not to be overly heady, but we control a lot of it, and it can be our passion and our ideas that can make massive change in the world. So take that position and take that power and take that authority that you have and the gift you have of being creative and visionary, and elevate it above just making something cool or that you love, and think about what it is we're involved in and have design create positive change. Thanks.